3.20 is finally live in Star Citizen, so come with me as I walk you through the paces and help you become a master miner in Star Citizen. And stick around to the end where I'm going to give you guys an incredible tip to give you an unfair advantage when you're out there mining. There are, of course, three types of mining in Star Citizen. You have hand mining, often referred to as FPS mining. This is typically reserved for those trying to get lucky in a cave searching for Janolite, or criminals. Rock mining, where Hadonite is king, but that can be a whole video by itself, so that just leaves ship mining. While ship mining has the most steps of the three, you also stake to get rich the easiest. First, you'll need a ship. Not just any ship, you'll need the Prospector or the Mole. What's the difference? Well, the short version of that is one is built for solo mining, the other is more for crew mining. The long version is
5 hours later.
And that's basically the ins and outs of them both. To start your mining journey, you'll need to head over to Lorville. In Tessa Spaceport, head on over to the New Deal, where you can purchase the Prospector for a little over 2 million AUEC. If you're irresponsible with your money, you can also grab it from the Pledge Store for $155. The Prospector comes with a single size 1 laser. This is a Arbor 1 laser when you first get the ship, and honestly, with the laser rebalance in 3.20, it's actually a solid starting laser. It comes with 4 ore canisters, but everyone just calls these saddlebags. It only has 32 SCU capacity, but these can be upgraded to a maximum of 48, but I'll get into that later. Keep in mind, this is ore capacity, not cargo capacity. It only has 1 seat, making the pilot also the laser operator. This is pretty handy, but it gets lonely when you're out there on a long mining run. The Prospector sports a bed for bed logging to avoid those pesky 30k server crashes when you're out and about. You'll notice your laser has something called module slots. These are special attachments for your mining laser that change its stats. This can allow you to create game-changing combinations and enable you to do more while you're out mining. Modules come in 2 varieties, active and passive. As you might expect, passive mods provide constant changes to your laser stats, while active mods provide changes for a limited time. Now that you know that, it likely won't surprise you to learn that active mods provide larger increases since they have limited uses. The most powerful active mods are the Surge, the Stampede, and the Torpid. The Surge and the Stampede both drastically improve laser power. The Surge drops rock resistance slightly, while the Stampede does the same thing but for instability. The Torpid is a handy module for new miners and support lasers on the Mole. It boosts optimum charge rate while also decreasing overcharge rate. You can immediately see the appeal here. To use these, check under keybinds to see where they are mapped. You can use one at a time or all at once. You can even use multiple of the same type of mod. Passive mods are not as strong but just as effective. A slight variation with these is that they come in tiers of 3, one being the worst and 3 being the best. The ones I would suggest are the Focus 3 for a large increase in charge window size while sacrificing a small portion of your laser power, the Riker C3 offering a robust increase in laser power and almost no loss in optimum charge window size. Lastly, I'd actually recommend the Torrent 3. In 3.19, I didn't think this was viable, but with the changes done to instability, I think it has a place in builds now. You can equip multiples of the same type and their effects will stack. Play around with different combinations to find what works for you. Keep in mind, a nerf that SIG implemented into mining is that the charge window can only make up 50% of the total charge bar, so no more of creating a giant green zone like people did before. While you're out shopping for modules, you should shop for a laser as well. If you're looking to upgrade, I have a couple of recommendations for you. The Hofstede has middle of the road power, but makes up for it with a healthy list of buffs. While it only has 1 module slot, the low minimum power and the very long effective laser range makes this a great choice for beginners or those looking for a bit more precision. The Impact laser, I would say, is the next natural step up from the Hofstede. The Impact has the same laser power as the Hofstede, although it has a higher minimum power, making this harder to control. The benefit here is it has 2 module slots instead of 1, allowing for more customization. Lastly is the Helix. This bad boy has the highest laser power of all the size 1s. This comes at a price, as it gives you a minus 40% charge window size, making this a challenge for new miners. Just like the Impact, it has 2 module slots, so you could combat this if you really wanted to. The effective range of the Helix is really, really close, guys, so it's very unforgiving if you overcharge a rock when using this. With our laser all sorted, it's time to head out. When choosing a planet to mine on, it's helpful to avoid those that have windy weather. These will cause your ship to blow away, and it can be really annoying when you're out mining. Popular choices for many miners are Daymar, located around Crusader, Lyria, located around Artcore, and Ariel, located around Hurston. I'll be heading down to the surface of Ariel, one of my usual stomping grounds. Now that we have come this far, we need to find ore to mine. But what do we even mine in Star Citizen? The best ore in the game is called Quantanium. With a value of 25,000 AUEC refined per SCU, it's more than triple the next ore. I call the next group the Big Three: Bexalite, Gold, and Terranite. These all average around 7,500 AUEC per SCU. The middle of the road ores are Boris and Laranite, coming in around 3,000 AUEC. Beryl, Agresium, and Hephaestinite are the next three, coming in around 25 to 2700 AUEC. All other materials vary by planet and only are worth maybe about 400 total. You'll want to avoid these common materials if possible, but they are a reality of the loop. With all that in mind, let's get to searching. Start by sending out a ping by pressing and holding V for 1 or 2 seconds and then releasing. If there are deposits nearby, they'll appear as a little box with a group of bubbles. Switch to scanning mode by using left mouse click. You can adjust your scan angle by scrolling up and down on the mouse wheel to increase and decrease it respectively. With the scan angle reduced to 2 degrees, aim at the bubbles and ping again. You'll notice little white diamonds will appear. If they are in a tight-knit bundle, those are gems and those are for rock mining. We can ignore those. If they're spaced out, that means they're ore deposits, and the more, the better. Head over, and as you get closer, you'll see little rock symbols appear. Switch to mining mode by pressing M. This will allow you to scan rocks in great detail, and it will pull out your mining laser. As you aim at a rock, additional info will populate on the right side. Things like density and mass, instability, resistance, difficulty, and the ore distribution in the rock. A new helpful feature in 3.20 is you can see the SCU total as well. People used to have to calculate this on the side and go to other websites. Now it just tells it right there for you. In the center of the mining UI, you'll see two bars. The left bar reflects the distance from the rock. There's a dash indicating the optimal distance you should be at, and a hazard zone that grows if you overcharge a rock. The right side is the charge window, split into three segments: the white heat up zone, the green optimal zone, and the red overcharge zone. On the far left side of the mining interface, you'll see the mining modules section. This shows you all of the active and passive modules currently applied to your laser. On the bottom left is the mining laser itself. The outline portion tells you all the final stat numbers for the laser that you're using after all the effects have been applied. And the bottom right corner shows you your cargo capacity, up to 32 or whatever the maximum cargo capacity is for the ship that you're in. This is helpful to see how much you have left to go before you're at max capacity. The goal here is to heat up the rock to the optimal zone, then keep it there until it is fully charged from right to left. This can be done in fracturing mode. Any rocks outlined in yellow must be fractured, and any rock outlined in purple is able to be extracted. To fracture the rock, simply left-click your mouse while in fracturing mode, your laser will turn on. To adjust your mining laser power, hold left alt and use your mouse scroll wheel up and down to increase and decrease the laser power respectively. Adjust this until you have the rocks fractured and they're outlined in purple. Switch to extraction mode and scoop it up. Repeat the steps until your prospector is full. Next, we need to get rid of all of our ore. Let's head off to a refinery. I suggest going to the closest one to where you frequently like to mine to cut down on travel time. I like to always use the same refinery, so all my orders are at the same spot. This is helpful later when you're trying to transport it to the TDD. You don't have to bounce around to different refineries to scoop up all your orders. They're nice and consolidated in one place. Now, come with me to her L2 and I'll show you what I mean. Now that we are on the refinery floor, head to the upstairs office. You'll be greeted with two sets of terminals. The left pair allows you to sell your ore right away. This gets your money faster, but at half the value of refined. The other terminal, as you might have guessed, is for refining. Here, you can choose your refining method and what ores you want to refine. Ferron Exchange and Dink Solventation are the best refining methods and produce the same results, but Ferron Exchange is faster if you're willing to fork out the money to do so. You're not limited here, and you can stack as many orders as you'd like. Once these orders are complete, you're ready to sell. I will say I would invest into buying a Taurus or a Caterpillar first and just renting the prospector to start, rather than buying a prospector without having a big hauler. You'll thank me later when you're not making 100 trips to the TDD using a Cutlass Black. Once you have a ship to transport, return to the refinery terminal, load it all on board, and make your way to your preferred TDD and you're set. A bonus tip is to upgrade your saddlebags. You can't buy this upgrade per se, It'll cost you 10,000 AUC, but it's more than worth it. To do this, you'll need to accept the salvage mission for an Argo Mole. I've seen two of these so far. There's one that's in the rings of Yella, and there's another one that's around Hurston somewhere. And it costs $10,000 to accept. Make sure you bring a tractor beam along with you. Once you arrive, turn off your ship ports by pressing Alt-K. This will allow you to add and remove components if you didn't do it before. Simply take the old ones out and toss them aside. You won't be needing those again. Slap the mole bags on and boom, you now have 48 SCUs of space, a 50% increase in how much ore you can grab on any single run, which is half of what the mole can take. We aren't done yet. Head back to a spaceport and swap out a component, doesn't matter which one, and save the changes. You can swap it back afterward. Now those saddlebags have become a permanent part of your prospector, even if you have to claim it if it's destroyed or you lose it. I hope you found this helpful, and if there's a guide you guys want to see, please let me know in the comments. Thank you guys so much for watching, and we'll see you guys next time.